Welcome to Shilpi's Academy, Corporate and Management Accounting session. Okay, what is the name of the paper? First, what is the name of the paper? It is Corporate and Management Accounting. It is actually Module 2, Paper Number 5. So, this particular subject comprises of two subjects actually. This particular paper comprises of two subjects actually. That is Corporate Accounting and then Management Accounting. Corporate accounting covers about 60% of the weightage and management accounting part covers about 40% of the weightage. Okay, so what is our goal about this subject is, what is the final target after this session is, we have to score 60 plus marks in this particular subject. So why, what is the reason behind our goal is, this is basically a sum paper. So the valuer cannot actually interpret, or he cannot, it is not at his discretion. If the answer is going to be correct, then he should actually give full marks for the sum paper. Okay. So will this, okay, this is an accounts paper. So will this be very difficult for non-commerce students? No. Why? So next question arises, why is it not difficult for non-commerce students? So the reason behind this is, commerce students would have learnt only these two chapters before. All other chapters are new even for a commerce students. And in with regard to this chapter, a commerce student would know only the basics of this chapter. Otherwise, he would be very thorough only with this chapter. So that is only first chapter, we would have learned only the, like the commerce students would have learned only the first chapter before in 11th or 12th. All other chapters are going to be new for both commerce and non-commerce students. So non-commerce students need not worry that they are not very strong in accounts. Okay. So next, what is the question paper pattern? Yes. This is basically an MCQ paper, multiple choice question, the MCQ paper, that is each question will have four options. Each question will have four options and the students will have to choose the right option. And corporate accounting, from corporate accounting, they actually get 60 questions and from management accounting part, they'll get 40 questions. And this is computer based paper or OMR based paper. Till now it is only OMR based paper and there is no notification till date about changing it to computer based paper. So it is an OMR paper till date. And is there negative marking? Unfortunately, yes. 0.25 negative marking for every wrong answer. Every wrong answer, there is a 0.25 negative marking. Okay. So this is a sum paper. If it is going to be a normal sum paper, we'll get step marks and everything. So, but this is unfortunately an one dot paper and with negative marking. So how to approach this paper? How to learn this paper? So first step, we have to be very strong in theoretical aspect. And we have to be very strong in formulas. So step one, you should know theory and formulas. Step two, what we have to do is, we should solve descriptive type questions. The institute will actually give a step from in between the, like, for example, there might be a 20 mark question and somewhere in between step only, they'll give us a question for a one word paper. So you should know to solve this entire 20 mark question to solve this one mark question. So it is better to learn how to solve all the descriptive questions. And last step only, we should practice or solve MCQs. So before directly, instead of going directly to the MCQs, we should first be thorough with theory and then formulas, and then we should solve all the descriptive questions like 20 mark question or 16 mark question or 5 mark question. We should be very thorough about solving these descriptive questions, and last step only we should solve MCQ questions. So next, with regard, first we will check the syllabus. Yeah. As we all know, corporate accounting will cover 60% of the weightage, and then management accounting part will cover 40% of the weightage. So what corporate accounting, what corporate is accounting is all about is, we are all going to be future CS. Role of a CS in a company is key managerial person. So his role is not somewhere with regard to recording the accounting entries or consolidating the entries or nothing. His role is all about decision making, and he will be dealing with all big corporates. So he should know to understand, a key managerial person or a CS should know to understand the balance sheet and accounts of a corporate. So in corporate accounting, we'll deal about accounts, how accounts are maintained in big corporates. And with regard to management accounting, they deal with all about managerial decisions, how decisions are taken and how to prepare reports to the top level management. All these are dealt in management accounting. Okay. Initially, first chapter is financial accounting. In financial accounting, it is all about basics, how ledger is made, how journal is recorded, how ledger and from ledger to trial balance and trial balance to P&L and balance sheet. So all this is dealt in first chapter. And corporate accounting, this chapter deals about share capital, how shares are issued, how to account for issue of shares, how to account for forfeiture of shares, and how to account for buyback of shares, and how to account for ESOP, and how to account for sweat equity shares, etc. will be dealt in second and third chapter. With regard to second chapter, they will be dealing with all how Schedule 3 format P&L and Schedule 3 format P&L and balance sheet is prepared is mainly focused in second chapter, and third chapter is all about issue of shares and exit and such things, and accounting for debentures. Accounting for debentures is again how shares are issued, etc. is all dealt in fourth chapter. Related aspects to company accounts and whatever is left over will be dealt in fifth chapter, related aspects to company accounts. And sixth chapter deals with interpretation of financial statements. That is, we would have recorded few transactions initially, but as a key managerial person, we should actually know to translate these financial transactions into words. We have to explain it to the top management. We have to interpret what the financial statement is communicating. So that part is dealt in chapter 6. And then consolidation of financial accounts as per Companies Act 2013. That is, there is a holding company. It acquires a small company. That is, it is acquiring a subsidiary company. So how to consolidate the balance sheet of holding and subsidiary company is dealt in consolidation of accounts. And then corporate financial reporting, it will deal about reporting aspects. And then cash flow statement. Cash flow statement is nothing but a normal cash account where we are splitting the transaction based on activities, that is operating activity, investing activity, and financing activity. It is a normal cash account, but in normal cash account, we will not split the activities, but in case of cash flow statement, we will split the transaction based on their nature. And then accounting standard, national and international accounting authorities. For example, ICSI is an accounting authority in India. Likewise, ICAI is an accounting authority in India. Likewise, we will have accounting authorities nationally and internationally. So this chapter deals with all these accounting bodies. And then last one, we will learn about IFRS and AS in accounting standards in India. And then with regard to management accounting, first one, overview of cost. Overview of cost is nothing but it is all basics. basic overview of cost, and then cost accounting records and cost audit. This chapter deals with how cost accounting records are maintained and how cost audit is done by a cost accountant or like a CMA qualified, how he will do a cost audit. Such aspects are dealt in cost accounting records and cost audit. And 15th chapter is budget and budgetary control. Here we will deal with all forecasting aspects. That is, say for example, we are now in the year 2020. So we might have to know how much sales we will do in the year 2021, 22, 23. And the same way, we might need the data for how much expenses we will be doing in the next years. So such data are dealt in chapter 15, ratio analysis. Ratio analysis is nothing but to know the financial position of a company, whether a company is sound or not, will be very easily predicted using a ratio analysis, using all these tools in ratio analysis. And then management reporting. Management reporting is nothing but how reports are sent to top level management. That is, as a key managerial person, we will have to report certain aspects to CEOs and directors of the company. That is top level management. So how such reports are to be prepared are dealt in management reporting chapter. And then decision making tools are like, we may go for further expansion, and sometimes we might cut down our expansion. Such decisions are taken using the tools that we are learning in decision making tools chapter. And then valuation principles and framework, how we are going to value our company, how we are going to value our assets, everything is dealt in valuation principles and framework. And here, how to value our shares is dealt in chapter 20 and 21, share based payment. For example, we are going to purchase an asset using how we will purchase an asset generally by paying cash. But if we are going to purchase an asset and in return, if we are going to give some shares instead of cash, we are giving them shares of our company, then how, in such cases, how to value the asset and how to value the shares are dealt in accounting for share based payment chapter. And then last one, methods of valuation. See, there are various methods to value our company. All that methods are dealt in chapter 22. So this is all about our syllabus. So just to have an idea about how our lectures are going to be, we will have a small session about the first chapter alone, and then we will have further details in next coming classes. Okay, first chapter is introduction to financial accounting. First one, anything, we will be starting with the definition only. So first, accounting definition. Accounting is the systematic process of identifying measuring, recording, classifying, summarizing, interpreting, and communicating financial information. Yes. Before going into this definition in depth, we will see this analysis of this definition on a later stage. So before going into this definition, we will see all other aspects of accounting, and then I will explain each and every word in this definition. That is, identifying, how identifying is done, how measuring is done, where recording is done, where classifying is done, where summarizing, everything I will explain in explain later. So before going into that, we'll see few other aspects. That is, accounting procedure can be basically divided into two parts. That is, generating financial information, generating financial information and then using financial information. Generating financial information is generally done in the stage of bookkeeping itself. That is, we will generally record the transaction. So while at the time of recording the transaction itself, we will generate financial information. But where we will use this financial information? We will use this financial information only for managerial decision making. So accounting is not a smaller concept. It is a very wide concept where we will first generate the financial information and then we will use these financial information for decision making processes. Okay. So first one, bookkeeping. Bookkeeping is an activity concerned with recording and classifying financial data related to business operation in order of its occurrence. Nothing. Bookkeeping is nothing but it is just recording the transactions and nothing more. But accounting actually deals with something more than bookkeeping. Accounting does not end only in the stage of recording. Why? Accounting deals with one more aspect, that is using this financial information. We will calculate ratios, we will take decisions, we will use many other decision making tools to advise the top level management. So everything is based on accounting. So accounting does not end with bookkeeping, that is only recording, but does not end with recording alone. Okay, now we'll see the difference between bookkeeping and accounting. Bookkeeping, it is the process concerned with what? It is the process concerned with recording the transaction. Accounting, it is a process concerned with summarizing of the transaction. So bookkeeping deals with only journal, but whereas accounting deals with journal, ledger, trial balance, balance sheet and everything. That is that last part, balance sheet and P&L part are actually summarizing part, but bookkeeping ends at the stage of recording itself. So bookkeeping is a smaller concept, but accounting is a very wide or wider concept. Yes, there is no subfields for bookkeeping, but whereas accounting has various other subfields. Subfields of accounting, we will see another chart here, that is branches of accounting we will see. So at that time I will explain what are the subfields of accounting. And then financial position of the business dash be ascertained through bookkeeping records. Can or cannot? This is cannot be ascertained. Cannot be ascertained through bookkeeping records. But financial position of the business can be ascertained through on the basis of accounting reports. Why? In accounting, we will have P&L account balance sheet. So we will able to find the asset balance. We will able to find the liability side balance. We will know whether it is coming in profit or loss. So everything we will know. So financial position of the business can be ascertained on the basis of accounting records, but financial position of the business cannot be ascertained through bookkeeping records. Okay. First one, accounting cycle. So what is an accounting cycle? Where an accounting cycle starts? It starts with the transaction. So what do you mean by a transaction? So for this we will see transaction definition. An activity which involves transfer of money or money's worth from one person to another is a transaction. Say, imagine there is an employee in a company. He is getting an appreciation from his manager. But that appreciation is only in terms of words. He is just calling him and he is appreciating. This is an activity. But here, there is no money involved. A mere appreciation in terms of words is not a transaction. In other case, just imagine the same employee is performing equally, like he is performing really good, and he is getting a bonus, or he is getting an extra payment in form of appreciation. In such case, then it will be recorded. Why? There is some money involved. So if a money is involved, then that is called as transaction. There was a manager and there is an employee. If he is simply appreciating him in terms of words, we will not record. That is not a transaction. If he is going to pay some money, if he is going to give some bonus, or if he is going to give some incentive for his better performance, then that is called as a transaction. This is as simple as that. So if there is a transaction, then we should record. How we will record? We will record it in the journal. And after recording it in the journal, we will post it in the ledger. Once all the ledgers are posted, towards the end of the year, what we will do is we will post the closing balance of the ledgers in trial balance. And once the trial balance is prepared, on the basis of the trial balance, we will prepare trading account, profit and loss account, and balance sheet. So in case of trading account, we will deal with all direct expenses and our material, that is whatever we are purchasing for the purpose of resale, will be recorded in trading account, and all the direct expenses will be recorded in trading account, and all other, and we will, from trading account we will get gross profit, and all other indirect expenses will be recorded in profit and loss account, and our assets and liabilities will be recorded in balance sheet. Yes, here we will get gross profit, and here we will get net profit, and this net profit will be transferred to balance sheet. We will record all the assets and liabilities, and we will also account our net profit in our balance sheet. And these assets here will be recorded in the, will be taken to the next year as opening entry. So current year we will close the balance sheet, and all these balances will be taken to next year as opening entry. Yes, and now we will go for this analysis of definition. Yes, first one, identifying. Identifying is nothing but whether we have to record this transaction or not. Let's take that manager employee example itself. In that case, if it is going to be only appreciation, then we will not record. Otherwise, if we are going to pay some incentive, then we will record. So we will have to first identify whether we will have to record this transaction or not. And then we will have to measure. How we will measure? How much amount we are paying to that employee is the stage of measuring. We will measure it in terms of amount, rupees, or depending on the country, it will change. So we will measure it in the terms of amount. And then recording. At what stage we are recording the transaction? At the stage of journal, we are actually recording the transaction. And then classifying, where we are classifying in the ledger, we are actually classifying the transactions. And then summarizing, trading and P&L account, and then balance sheet, we are summarizing the transaction. And then interpreting. Interpreting is nothing but we have to translate all the numbers in the balance sheet and trading P&L account to statement form to make even the person who are not well aware of this accounting terminologies to understand. So we have to interpret in such a manner, and then we will have to communicate this financial information. Why should we communicate these financial information? Yes, these financial informations are actually used by bankers, our debtors, creditors, our shareholders. So bankers might be aware of all these accounting terminologies. But imagine a shareholder, they will never be aware of these accounting terminologies. So in such case, we will have to make them understand these terminologies. So in for that purpose, we will have to interpret, and we should make it in a communicable manner. Okay, then who will use this financial information? Yes, internal users, and then external users. Internal users are employees and shareholders. External users are investors, suppliers, government, customers, bank, etc., etc., are external users of our financial information. And then branches of accounting. Before itself, I told you something here. There are several subfields. So subfields are nothing but branches of accounting. Yes. Financial accounting, cost accounting, social responsibility accounting, management accounting, environmental accounting. Financial accounting is nothing but whatever we are recording in the books is all financial accounting. That is journal, ledger, everything is financial accounting. Management accounting, using these financial like data from these financial accounting records, we will make decisions, and such part is known as management accounting. And then cost accounting. Cost accounting is actually used to calculate what will be the cost of the product that I am manufacturing. This is actually very useful. For example, if our estimate is going to be 40 rupees to manufacture a product, and if actual expenses incurred is rupees 50, then we can find that there is a deviation of rupees 10. Cost accounting actually helps to calculate this 40 first, and then it actually helps to know why this difference of 10 rupees has occurred. So in case if this budgeting is wrong, then we can change this budget. Otherwise, if there is somewhere, if the expense is going to be overloaded, then cost accounting helps to trace actually where the expenses are incurred more, and it helps to cut down the expenses. And so now cost accounting is over. Then environmental accounting. Environmental accounting actually helps to know how much we are polluting the environment, how much we are actually depleting the resources from the environment. So all this is dealt in environmental accounting, and it actually insists the fact that we should give back to the environment whatever we have depleted. So that is actually it actually measures in quantum how much we have depleted. See, instead of measuring, I have cut down 5 trees. If we are going to measure it in terms of amount, that is what is all about environmental accounting. And then social responsibility accounting. Social responsibility accounting is nothing but it deals with CSR activities. Like we have to help the society around the company in terms of education, or in terms of like we can contribute to the nature, so etc., etc., are dealt in social responsibility accounting. We should be very concerned about the society around the company. So yes, next we will talk about all those important terminologies in accounting. So transaction, we have already seen, anything which involves money is known as transaction. So in that, there are two types, that is cash transaction and credit transaction. Cash transaction is nothing but if we are immediately paying cash, then that is called as that is called as cash transaction. And if we are going to get the benefit now, and if we are going to pay for it on a later stage, then that is known as credit transaction. And next one is account. Account is nothing but, for example, if we are going to measure weight, we will measure it in kg. Similarly, in accountancy, we will use the term account to denote something. It is a unit of measurement, that's all. For measuring distance, we will use the term kilometer or meters or centimeters. Same way, here we will use the term account. An account is opened individually for a person. To denote a person also, we will use the term account. To denote an asset also, we will use the term account. To denote an expense, income, for everything, we will use the term account. And then capital. Capital is nothing but the initial investment made by the owner or the shareholder. In case of a company form of organization, the owners are called as shareholders. Otherwise, in case of a sole proprietary concern, then he'll be known as an owner or a proprietor. In case of a partnership concern, they are known as partners. So whatever the money they contribute towards the organization is known as capital. And drawings, if they are going to take their money outside the organization, that is known as drawings. Then comes voucher. Voucher is nothing but it is a common terminology. We may pay cash, we may issue invoice, or we may issue a bank slip. All these are known as vouchers. Whatever written document or printed document in support of some transaction is known as a voucher. Invoice is nothing but at the time of sales, we will actually give a sales bill. That sales bill is known as an invoice. And in invoice, we will have the split up of tax amount, quantity, value, price, and everything. So all these together is known as an invoice. And then goods. Goods is nothing but an article which we are purchasing for the purpose of resale is known as goods. All purchases is not known as goods. For example, if we are a manufacturing concern, what we are going to manufacture? We are going to manufacture rubber. And I am going to purchase a machinery for manufacturing this, instead of rubber, not rubber, I love it as wheel. I'm going to manufacture tires, and I'm going to purchase a machinery for manufacturing this tire. Then this is not a good. If I purchase a rubber for the purpose of manufacturing of tire, then that is called as goods. So this is the basic difference between goods and asset. And purchases. Whatever I purchase for the sake of business is not purchases. If I'm going to purchase these goods, that is, if I'm going to purchase goods for the purpose of resale, then that is called as purchases. If I'm going to purchase machinery, or if I'm going to purchase some asset, then that is not termed as purchase. I will account it as an asset only. I will not account it as purchase. If I find some defective goods in such purchases, then I will return it back to my seller. Then that is called as purchase return. And then sales. Similarly, if I'm in this example itself, if I'm selling this tire, then that is called as sales. If I'm going to sell some machinery which I have purchased a few years back for the purpose of manufacture, then that is not termed as sales. That is entirely a different concept. Whatever I'm selling as a regular course of business will be termed as sales. And if there is some defective piece in the things that is in the articles which I have sold, then my customer will return back to me. And such items are known as sales returns. So till this, we will end this session. Rest, we will continue in the next session. Thank you.